وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to another episode from this series brought to you by Madrasatu Al Umariyyah around the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ And your Lord said, call upon me and I will answer you. So in this series, we are dealing all around the topic of dua, how to make dua, what causes your dua to be accepted, what are some of the obstacles that might prevent your dua from being accepted, what are some of the etiquettes of dua, how do you get near to Allah through your dua, and finally, what are some of the supplications that you can make that are authentically reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And having finished in the previous episodes the topic of the etiquettes of dua and the kind of theory of dua, we now move on to a new topic, and that is an explanation of some of the supplications of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a look at particularly those supplications which are comprehensive in nature. We're going to start by looking at a hadith of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, and this hadith is narrated by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, by Abi Dawood in his Sunan, and by Ibn Hibban in his Sahih rahimahumullah ta'ala. This is the hadith that our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعجبه الجوامع من الدعاء ويدع ما بين ذلك. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to love the supplications which were comprehensive in nature. That was what he used to focus on. And that's why when you look at many of the supplications of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are comprehensive and general in nature. And he used to give importance to those and prefer them over the supplications that were more specific in nature. And there are many reasons why that can be the case. First of all, with one simple dua, you cover many, many different situations. And that has multiple benefits to it. First of all, it means that for people who are just learning their supplications in Arabic, you can learn a single supplication that will cover many, many tens and hundreds of different situations that you might go through in your life. That's one reason why you might give attention to the comprehensive supplications. Another reason why you might give attention to the comprehensive supplications is because a person doesn't always know what's good for them. And a person, the more unspecific you become, the more likely it is that you fall into al-i'tida fi du'a. You fall into transgression and going over the limits as it relates to your du'a. You remember we covered an athar where one of the sahaba radiallahu anhum, they mentioned it, or they heard one of their children making dua, asking Allah for a palace on the right side, a white palace on the right side of Jannah. And we said that the more specific you become, it's easy to transgress in your dua. It's easy to ask for something that isn't right, or something that's not befitting, or something that's not good for you. So by keeping your dua comprehensive in nature, it allows or it protects you from transgression in your dua, and ultimately you will always get what is best for you, and you'll always get perhaps even some good will happen to you that you didn't expect would happen, or that it wasn't even something you were thinking about, but because of the general nature of that dua, then all of the aspects are covered. So let's have a look at a comprehensive supplication, an example of that from the hadith of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her, Ya Aisha, alayki bi jawami' al-du'a. He said, O Aisha, you should stick to, or you should take to, supplicating with comprehensive supplications. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave an example. Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kullih, ajilihi wa ajilih, ma 'alimtu minhu wa ma lam a'lam. O Allah, I ask you from every kind of good. من الخير كله. Every kind of good. عاجله, that which comes soon, which comes quickly. وآجله, that which comes later on, that which is delayed. And العاجل, it could refer to the dunya, and العاجل to the akhirah, or it could be even within the dunya, that you have العاجل, that which is the good comes to you immediately, and العاجل, that which the good comes to you later on. And we mentioned that your dua can be accepted in different ways, and one of the ways your dua can be accepted is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps that dua and stores it for you until يوم القيامة. And that's an example of الخير العاجل, the good which is delayed. And an example of al-khayr al-ajil is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers it for you immediately and gives you the thing that you've asked for immediately. So this dua, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kullihi. Oh Allah, I ask you for every kind of good. From every kind of good. Because ultimately a person doesn't know where the good is going to come from. A person doesn't necessarily know what's good for them. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Perhaps you might dislike something and Allah places within it a great deal of good. So you ask Allah for good from all the different kinds of good. There are good, or there are examples of good which comes to you, as we said, in the dunya, good which comes to you in the akhirah, good which comes to you immediately, good which comes to you later on. In all different areas, whether it is good in terms of your children, in terms of your family, in terms of your wealth, in terms of your religion, your knowledge, in terms of all of the different causes and types of good, you ask Allah from all of them, from all of the different types of good. What comes immediately or quickly, and what is delayed and comes later. مَا عَلِمْتُ مِنْهُ وَمَا لَمْ أَعْلَمْ. Those things that I know from it and those things that I don't know. And we mentioned that a person perhaps doesn't know what's good for them. Don't we hear this expression a lot? We hear people say to other people, you don't know what's good for you. But in terms of a human being in their relationship with Allah, that's absolutely true. That's absolutely true. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And Allah knows and you don't know. Allah knows what is good for you and you don't know what's good for you. So there may be things of the khair that you know that are good for you. You ask Allah for Jannah and you know that's good for you. And you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you some good in the dunya, you know that's good for you. But there may be things that you don't know that they're good for you. There may be things that, subhanAllah, imagine a person who doesn't know the virtue of knowledge. You know, okay, they appreciate people of knowledge, but they've never thought about how virtuous it is to study Islam and learn Islam. It's never occurred to them, or they've never really come across the hadith in that regard. They're praying their prayers, they're coming close to Allah, but they've never really thought about it. They might not say, Rabbi zidni ilma, my Lord increase me in knowledge, because they haven't appreciated how important it is. So this could be from the khair that they don't know about, something that is very good for them, but they don't know how good it is for them. A person could be engaged in something in their job which is not good for them, but they can't quite see that the job is not good for them. Where they're seeing it, they don't see it that way, or they haven't come to appreciate it that way. So there can be elements of good that you know and elements of good that you don't know. And then this dua is so comprehensive that it doesn't just talk about good. It also talks about the bad things that can happen to a person. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ الشَّرِّ كُلِّهِ عَاجِلِهِ وَآجِلِهِ مَا عَلِمْتُ مِنْهُ وَمَا لَمْ أَعْلَمْ. And I seek refuge with you from all kinds of evil. عَاجِلِهِ, the evil which comes immediately or the evil which comes quickly. وَآجِلِهِ, and the evil which is delayed. And again, that could be delayed until after a person dies. It could be delayed in terms of their life in this worldly life. مَا عَلِمْتُ مِنْهُ, that which I know of. وَمَا لَمْ أَعْلَمْ, and that which I don't know of. Because again, a person may know of certain evils and be asking Allah and saying, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min adhabi jahannam wa min adhabi al-qabr wa min fitnatil mahya wal mamat wa min sharri fitnatil masih al-dajjal. There may be things that people know about. The fire, the punishment of the grave, the dajjal, they ask Allah to keep them safe. But there may be other evils that a person doesn't doesn't appreciate or hasn't learned about or doesn't realize are going to happen to them. So they ask Allah to keep them safe from those evils, whatever I know from it and whatever I don't know. The dua continues, Allahumma inni as'aluka min khayri ma sa'alaka minhu Muhammadun abduka wa nabiyyuk sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O Allah, I ask you from the good of which your slave and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked you. This here has an indication of following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we know that we have a principle that we take from this statement that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, that there was no good except that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught it to his ummah. And there was no evil except that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned his ummah about it. And so when you ask Allah Azza wa Jal with what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, you bring all the good, every possible opportunity and every possible kind of good is in what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught and what he asked for. And every kind of evil is in opposing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and going away from his sunnah. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا عَادَ مِنْهُ عَبْدُكَ وَنَبِيُّكَ. And I seek refuge with you from the evil of which your servant and your prophet sought refuge with you from. And that also indicates to us that there are many things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to supplicate to Allah Azza wa Jal for. And again, we may not have memorized all of the hadith in that regard, but here we have a comprehensive dua where we say, whatever your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to ask you for, we ask you from that. And whatever he used to seek refuge with you from, we seek refuge with you from that. And the hadith continues, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannah wa ma qarraba ilayha min qawlin wa amal. O Allah, I ask you for paradise and what brings near to it, what brings a person near to it, whether statements or actions. Asking Allah for Jannah is one of the most important pillars of dua, one of the most important features of dua. And that's why when the man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but I ask Allah for Jannah and I ask him to keep me safe from the fire. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's these two things that we are murmuring about. It's these two things that we are asking Allah for. So ultimately, all of the things that you're asking Allah for are based around asking Allah for Jannah and asking Allah to keep you away from the fire. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-Jannah. Or Allah, I ask you for Jannah. And I ask you for the statements and actions that will bring me near to it. Because ultimately, Jannah, in order to be from the people of Jannah, we have to bring the conditions and we have to bring the actions that are the cause for the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal that causes a person to be from the people of Jannah. So ultimately you enter Jannah by the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. You don't enter Jannah by simply doing good deeds. But those good deeds are the key to the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala indicated and others. And therefore you're asking Allah for the statements and actions that are the statements and actions of the people of Jannah that bring a person near to Jannah. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ النَّارِ. And I seek refuge with you from the fire. وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ وَعَمَلٍ. And whatever brings near to the fire, whether statements or actions. Whether statements or actions. And we know again, what causes the people to be dragged on their faces into the fire except for the hasa'id, the what they have reaped from the statements of their tongue. So we know that there are statements that bring a person near to the fire and there are actions that bring a person near to the fire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. We ask Allah's refuge from them. And then the dua concludes, وَأَسْأَلُكَ مَا قَضَيْتَ لِي مِنْ قَضَاءٍ أَنْ تَجْعَلَ عَاقِبَتَهُ رُشْدًا. And I ask you that whatever decree that you have decreed for me, that the end result, that the end result is one of rushd. Here it could be a one of guidance or a positive, that it brings the end result for me. The aqibah of it is something good. And that is very, there's a very subtle understanding there. which is that many times the actual event that happens to you in the moment might be an event that is difficult for you to bear. It might be an event that is quote unquote bad for you. A calamity, a hardship, a problem, a suffering, a sickness that happens to you. But it's not what happens to you at that moment that matters. But it's what the aqibah of that is. What is the outcome of it? Is it that it brings you nearer to Allah or it takes you further away from Allah? And that's why people often ask you the question, is Allah punishing me by these negative things that are happening to me? Am I suffering from them because I've done something? What does this mean for me? But it's not the qada itself that happens to you at that moment is not what matters. But what matters is the outcome of it, the aqibah of it. Is it an aqibah which is hamida, which is praiseworthy, where a person became near to Allah, they became sick, they become near to Allah. They suffered, they become near to Allah. They had a calamity happen to them, they repented. It's a positive outcome. Or is it a negative outcome, where a person had something happen to them and it took them away from Allah? So we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla that whatever you have decreed for me, make the final outcome of that decree, the end result of that decree, make it something which is praiseworthy, something which is guided, something which is, you can say, it's good for you. These are all some of the meanings of ar-rushd. So this is a comprehensive dua that the Prophet ﷺ told Aisha, and he said to her, عَلَيْكِ بِجَوَامِعِ الدُّعَى. O Aisha, you should make comprehensive supplications. And if you look at one of the most common supplications that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make, as Anas radiallahu anhu told us about, that the dua that he heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam making again and again in sujood, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. This dua has, again, it's comprehensive. Everything is found within it. So a person might have listened to this long dua and said, well, it's very long dua. How will I learn such a long dua? It will take me time. But there are comprehensive supplications which are very short, like Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana. Our Lord, Rabbana, you're coming close to Allah with his rububiyyah. And that was the way of the prophets, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, that they would come close to Allah through ar-rububiyyah, through Allah's lordship. And the fact that Allah nurtures them and takes care of them. Rabbana atina, O Allah, give us fi dunya hasana. In this world, everything. Hasana here is a lafz which is am. It's a general term that covers everything which is hasan. Everything which is good and beautiful. Everything which is good for you. Give me anything that's good for me in the dunya, give it to me. Wa fil akhirati hasana. And everything that's good for me in the akhirah, give it to me. وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And protect us from the punishment of the fire. And this also indicates that everything good that happens to you in this world happens to you from the grace of Allah. And everything good that happens to you in the hereafter happens to you from the grace of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So if you want good in the dunya, you seek it from Allah. And if you want good in the akhirah, you seek it from Allah Azza wa Jal. And the sunnah is that you don't ask Allah Azza wa Jal for the dunya alone. You don't just ask Allah for the dunya and not ask Allah for the rest or for the akhirah. Rather, you ask Allah for the dunya and the akhirah together. There are some people, فَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَمَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَقٍ. There are some people who they say, our Lord, give us in the dunya, but they don't have any share in the hereafter. And there are those who say, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا. There are those who say, give us good in the dunya, وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا. And good in the akhirah, وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And protect us from the punishment of the fire. And that, again, we've talked about how many of the du'as, huge majority of the supplications which are comprehensive revolve around that which will bring you to Jannah and that which will keep you safe from the fire. And bringing all of this together in a very short statement that many of us know. So this is another example of al-jawami', the comprehensive supplications that we can make. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to continue with that in the next episode by the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's what Allah made easy for me to mention in this episode, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.